And away we go. Ham Radio Now, episode 126. Oh, that's harsh. Yeah, but I guess we better do this. Kickstarter fail. And a bunch of other stuff. So keep watching. We'll talk about the Kickstarter first. I got a bunch of stuff in this episode. And so I've got my brain here. Oh, I've got a camera you can see my brain at, too. I got my brain here to remind me of all the stuff I've got to do. So I'm not going to stare at you there in the camera. I'm going to be looking down here. So the Kickstarter blew up. Well, it didn't blow up. I guess that's the problem. Let's take a look. That's not it. That should get me there. All right. There's the Kickstarter. Let me zoom in a little bit. Well, and this is the Kickstarter, not for the Tapper stuff, because that was eminently successful. This is the Kickstarter to get out to the Orlando and Dayton Hamfests. And it finished off almost a week ago. I've been busy. So I wanted $8,000. 20 people came together and pledged a grand total of $828, which is far short of the funding goal. And Kickstarter is an all or nothing deal. So if you don't make it, I don't get the 800. I don't get anything. And the folks who made those pledges don't have to pay anything. Although anybody who wants to can still go to hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin. Hey, Arvin, how you doing back there? Have you been feeling left out because we've been doing all the Kickstarter stuff? Yeah, you got a job now. You can go by the Ham Radio Now website and click on Arvin and make individual contributions. People have still been doing that. I was going to say you can do it again. People have not stopped doing that since then. It's just never been a serious source of... Well, it's been serious enough. I mean, it's real money, thousands of dollars a year, but not enough to get me where I need to go with this program in terms of being just about full-time work. Where was I going here? Oh, so why did the Kickstarter fail? Why do I think that we had this problem? Well, I mean, we can start with the idea that people just didn't care very much about the concept of these programs. Me and Jeff or Cliff going out to the Hamfests, doing tours and talking to people and doing interviews and stuff like that. Those programs have been about as popular as anything else. Some of them more, depends on who we're talking to and what we're doing. You know, they get, somewhere between 1,000 and 2,000 views. So I don't think that was so much it, but it certainly, you know, not something that was compelling, bringing you in with a built-in sort of an audience like the Tapper stuff did. I mean, that stuff had a, its own built-in audience. Probably some bad timing. The Kickstarter went across the holidays, you know, so everyone's busy and distracted and doing other stuff. And they've also spent all their money buying presents for people, which is a good thing to do. The Kickstarter was apparently well ahead of the Hamfests. I mean, Orlando is just coming up in a couple of weeks. So I had that set the timing for getting things set for the Kickstarter and for setting a deadline. So if it had been successful, I wouldn't have known until last Friday, and then only 3 weeks to get ready for Orlando. So that's what set the timing, and it's just not good timing. With Orlando and then Dayton way out into May, things just didn't seem very urgent. I didn't do any promotion. I've been spending all of the time that I've got to spend on this stuff doing the Tapper stuff. So I didn't get online. I didn't send out mailings and postings and wherever I could. And I especially didn't approach any small ham radio businesses. I'd set up a bunch of $500 reward settings that I had designed for medium to small ham radio businesses to get underwriting, online on-air mentions of their support for the Hamfest videos. And hopefully you've been enjoying the underwriting announcements that I've been making for the folks that supported the Tapper ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference, and there's still a few more to go of those, and we're not done with those yet. I just thought I would take a little break and address this Kickstarter thing. As it turns out, I had intended to do like a little 10 seconds of the of three of the four. There were four. There was Tapper. There was Tapper, Flex, and Ellicraft. There were three. Three major contributors. And I intended to do like a 10-second announcement for two of them and then about 2 minutes or so on one of them, rotating that two-minute announcement. And as you can tell, I've done, if you've been watching those episodes, I've tended to do a minute or two on the short ones and then 3 or 4 minutes on the long ones. Totally out of control. Anyway, I didn't approach any of the potential businesses. And so I thought, well, let's just see where this goes organically. I wouldn't have been able to do any more than I did because I just didn't have time. So I thought, well, let's just see what happens. Let's see if the audience does anything about it, and you didn't. Or if you did, it didn't go anywhere, except for the 20 people that, where are we? 20 people that that did make pledges to it. But beyond that, it really didn't go anywhere. It either didn't get known to buy or was not interesting to anybody who runs a small ham radio business, because nobody pledged at the $500 level. So will I ever do something like that again? Maybe. There are some other funding alternatives, and I've been learning about more of them besides Kickstarter, besides something that's all or nothing. I may look into those. My experience with doing underwriting / commercials has been interesting. Again, out of control, unable to stop myself from talking about the folks that that made the substantial contribution to the DCC Kickstarters. So I might do that, but it is what I found it to be is time consuming. When I need to be concentrating on getting the episodes done, and I'm taking time to do the underwriting, and I probably should have sort of built three canned, play them every time the same thing announcements, so I could get them through really quickly. But I feel terrible about doing that. I don't like sending you in the audience exactly the same thing over and over and over again. So, haven't been able to, probably won't now. Will it affect the potential for doing underwriting or commercials or something like that in the future? I don't know. Haven't thought about it. So let's see. Am I disappointed? Well, when I did Jeff and I did a video for the Kickstarter and for something earlier than that, an episode where we sort of embedded the Kickstarter announcement. What I said was that I have high hopes for something like this, but low expectations. You maybe sabotaged myself. I didn't really expect it to go through. I hadn't really expected the DCC Kickstarter to be successful and was sort of surprised, pleasantly surprised when it did. Glad to go out to a Seattle, glad to be putting these things together. Sorry that I'm taking longer than I thought to get them online. And I will do the reward fulfillment. I owe a bunch of people, as soon as I get everything done, little USB sticks with the programs on them. Some getting the whole thing, some just getting a few. A few folks opted for DVDs, which I signed up for early and or put as a reward early and then said, no, we can do better than DVDs. So I'll give them the option. We can go to a memory stick. And there's some cool new 32-gigabyte USB 3 memory sticks. They're not real cheap. I think they're about $35 on Amazon right now from SanDisk, but that's what I'll use because they're got good reviews. I kind of wish this one had been successful. I would like to go. I don't know whether I'm going to be able to go to Dayton. I'm sure I'm not going to be able to go to Orlando. I've looked at the bank account. Not enough money to be able to go to Orlando. By Dayton time, contributions may have built the bank account up enough. And just working freelance, I really don't want to subsidize Ham Radio Now anymore with freelance work. I mean, that's got to pay for groceries and rent and stuff, you know, life. I don't want to subsidize Ham Radio Now anymore. I want to do what you guys find that you are willing to put in a contribution for. And I'll do that much. So what would come next? Well, let's see. We make lemonade from the lemons. It's going to be a lot more Skype. This is what I intended to do from the beginning. And I got caught up going to the ham fests, and you know, the DCC will be something different. You know, for next or this year's DCC this September, I'm probably going to be in Austin. That's where they're aiming. I'll do another Kickstarter. Chances are that one has a lot better chance of being successful, although people may be mad at me for being late with this one. But I think they like the quality of the programs that have come out. But speaking of which, you may have noticed that some of the video is kind of noisy, especially from the camera that's the close-up one on the guy doing the talking. It was very dark in there, very dark in the room. They darken those rooms because you've got a projector and people want to be able to see that. It was darker than it needed to be. But I also didn't have very much time for setup. I wasn't able to get into the facility to do any actual physical setup until a couple of hours before the first presentation on Friday morning. I was told I wouldn't be able to see it at all until then. I was actually able to walk into it on Friday night. And I could tell that it was going to be a problem. But I couldn't set up any equipment, couldn't do any testing. And by the time I could and discovered that the lighting setup that they had with some spotlights here and there, they had spotlights that were pointed at the lectern where the speaker was talking, but nobody knew how to turn them on. To turn them on brought up lights every place in the room, and that washed out the screen. So we found the best compromise, but the guy talking was sort of in the dark. So the camera that was pointed at him was not the best camera. It wasn't the one I'm looking at right now. The best camera was the wide one sitting at the back of the room. The camera that was pointed at him was one of my HC9s, a Sony $1,000 camera, single chip camera. So things look a little bit noisy. But I think in general, I'm pretty happy with what I got. Very happy with the way Wirecast worked out in terms of being able to switch the cameras live. That has saved a lot of editing time, which I've then put into making commercials. I can't win. So anyway, there'll be more Skype. And that'll give me the opportunity to talk to people around the country, around the world, I hope, and react faster to stories and events that are going on. There have been a bunch of those over the past month or so that I really would have liked to have been working on. But instead of doing those, I concentrated on doing the Tapper videos because I was late doing them. Some of them I was thinking about were like the Philippines hurricane. I guess they call it a cyclone down there. I would have liked to have gotten some of those guys online. The ones that were in safe areas and not really busy doing stuff, and talk to them about what they did. I still may. The story won't be news, but their stories of what they did, I think, will still be compelling. So I'll still give that a try. There were tornadoes in Indiana and Illinois. Pretty serious ones. Would have been interesting to talk to those guys and see what they were doing. The FCC, the ARL, has put in a request for rulemaking on digital bandwidth. And let's see, I got something here on that. It's not an old story. The comment time for it has gone by, but the reply comment time is still open, and it's gotten lots and lots of comments, 923 comments, and again, they're doing the reply comments now. I haven't even taken the time to totally dig into what is going on. What I understand about it is the ARRL has proposed setting up a 2.8 kilohertz bandwidth cap or limit for data on the HF bands below 29-something megahertz. And that would be across the band, the whole band, lower part of the band, upper part of the band. The what they're getting, and within that bandwidth, you could operate any data mode that is legal to operate at any baud rate or anything like that. And again, I'm not an expert on where we've been and where they want to go, but from what I've read, the FCC rules are way, way, way out of date, written back in the 80s sometime, limiting the symbol rate, but not the bandwidth and not the data rate and not all the stuff that we're used to dealing with in terms of digital transmissions today. So those rules need to be brought up to date. And that's what the notice is all about. An interesting thing to me, and something I would like to talk to some experts about, is that they're still maintaining the distinction between what makes up that data. The stuff in the upper parts of the band, the part of the band we've typically referred to as the phone bands, would still be where you could put digital voice and not text-based or other kinds of data. And in the 2.8 kilohertz. In the bottom part of the band, the stuff we have typically called the CW band, but where all the other data goes, teletype and PSK, things like that, still 2.8 kilohertz wide, and that would allow modes like Winlink's, their newest mode, the one we can't use, but Mars can use, and all of the people would like to be able to use because the data throughput is so much better. I mean, we can use modes up to 2.8 kilohertz or wider down there, but we can't use that. So, you know, that's the kind of thing that the ARRL is trying to get through. But not voice. So it's data at the top with voice in it and no text, and data at the bottom with text in it and no voice. There are some historic reasons for doing things that way. Part of it has got to do with the idea that we like talking better than we like sending Morse code and doing just about anything else. And that if we allowed talking any place, talking would just take over every place. Or at least that's what we're worried about. So I think that's the background of it. That will be something I want to talk to some folks about. There are multiple sides to this issue because there are people that are not happy with it. And people that have filed comments on it. In fact, let's see what we've got here. I guess I don't have that story up here. One of the things that the ARRL has been pointing out is that a lot of the folks that have been filing comments don't understand the concept. They're worried that again, digital signals are just going to run roughshod over everything in the bottom end of the band and take over. And they don't think that's the case. We've been through this before, back in the mid-2000s. Here I've got something up here. If you recall, and this is a story on QRZ.com from the end of 2005, ARRL files regulation by bandwidth petition. So you may remember those terms, regulation by bandwidth. And again, I haven't researched this one thoroughly to remember what went on, but what I remember is they set up some bandwidth limits, narrow toward the bottom end of the band, I think 500 hertz, and then wider toward the top end of the band. And once again, big firestorm, everybody got upset about what might happen if that became the way things were. And again, you could do anything you wanted to do within those limits. And at that point, if you could do voice in 500 hertz, you could do voice. We're getting there. The free DV stuff has got pretty decent voice down to 1.1 kilohertz. So they're working their way down to 500 hertz. Let me see if this story says exactly what that was. And let's see. 200 hertz to 100 hertz. 200 hertz to 100 kilohertz. So, yeah, 500 hertz might have been a little bit wide. Might have been 200 hertz. In any case, boom, it got so many complaints that the ARRL withdrew the petition. And so it eventually went no place. They are at some pains, at least including some language to say that their current proposal is not regulation by bandwidth. And I asked Dave Sumner if he could talk to me. This would have been early in December. if he could talk to me about this when it was first coming out. And he was not available the week I wanted to talk. And then he said he'd get back to me, but he didn't. He probably got busy and I got busy and I didn't go pester him about it. So maybe we will. In any case, that is currently up and it is something that I want to do as a program as soon as I can. We'll get the Tapper stuff done first. There are some folks at Tapper that have talked about it and they'd be good people to bring on the program. Let's see. Monitoring times is being replaced. You may have recalled that if you watch this episode 89, that I talked to Bob Grove, who was the editor of Monitoring Times, and decided he was going to retire and shut down the magazine. So it has been replaced by this, the Spectrum Monitor. And now it's time for me to go talk to those guys and see what they're up to. It's an online-only magazine. and I think they're doing it in PDF format. So we'll go find out what that's all about. I had a chance to, an offer to operate W1AW portable station that's moving around the country. You know, this is the 100th anniversary of the founding of the ARL. And one of the activities that they're doing is operating W1AW from individual hams stations in two states at a time and moving it around the country. And I think it was Virginia or West Virginia and North Carolina were the first that got the opportunity to do that. And the section manager, Bill Marine, N2COP, now the outgoing section manager from North Carolina, checked with me and asked if I would be interested to be one of those stations and do a story about it. Bill isn't coordinating this, but he knows the guys that were and put in a good word for me. And I just ran out of time before I was able to do it. Listen, some they're getting big pileups, and the way they're doing it is they didn't haul equipment out of headquarters from W1AW, which is now, by the way, operating as W100AW. Thanks to a special dispensation by the FCC, the use of that special call sign. But W1AW is operating portable out of individual ham stations, and the folks that are coordinating it move it around. So maybe, I think they're at a week or so, maybe 2 weeks at in each two-state pair. And within that time, a bunch of hams get to operate. They're setting up schedules. They operate for a few hours. And I don't even think they've been able to fill every time slot that they've got available. But they're moving around from band to band and from mode to mode. So if you look on the DX clusters or the DX spotting websites, you can find out where they are. They've been very popular. I've been listening to some big pileups when the station's been on the air. I haven't dug into all of this. I should have at least brought up their website. There's some awards that you can go for if you worked all states from the W1AW stations. And interestingly, they are signing in a way that we used to have to sign our call signs many, many years ago, something you haven't heard very much and something most newer hams don't understand because they've never heard anybody say this. They'll be saying portable and then the a call sign zone that they're in. So when they were down here, it was W1AW portable 4. Once in a while, I still do that. If I'm mobile, I'll say KN4AQ mobile 4, mobile 8, wherever I am. Just for old time's sake. We don't have to do that anymore. The zone system has been pretty much destroyed. You can't tell where someone is by the number in their call sign. All right. So there's also some things that I haven't had much of a chance to do before that I would like to do once I can talk to people on Skype several times a week. At least I'm hoping it'll be several times a week. I want to do DX. I want to talk to folks who are involved in DX, talking about some DX expeditions and some things that are coming up, maybe some things that are ongoing. A lot of folks who are doing DX expeditions, they're not operating from a nailed together milk crate on Kingman Reef. They're in a nice hotel someplace and maybe have even Skype and could talk to me a little bit. Or if they're on the nailed together a milk crate on Kingman Reef. Maybe they've got somebody else here that can tell me how things are going. And then you know, talk to folks who have been sitting on a milk crate on Kingman Reef for 2 weeks, swatting mosquitoes and trying to keep their generator going when the tide is threatening to put the whole thing underwater. It can't go underwater. It's got to stay up at high tide or it can't be a DX entity. I know that much about DX. Anyway, and contests, pretty much same deal. Contests that are coming up, contests that are going on, contests that have happened. I think there's some interesting things to talk about to people who are doing things like that. And I haven't gotten into either DX or contesting much, so it's about time that I did. There's an audience for that. We need more Jeff. I know you want more Jeff. I want more Jeff. Jeff wants to do technical stuff. Got that workbench space over there. I don't have a camera pointed at it, and it's a good thing because it's a mess. We need more Jeff. All right, so the idea is to put, you ready for a slogan? To put the now back in ham radio now. I hate doing that stuff. All right, so that's the Kickstarter lemonade from lemon stuff. Let me talk about a few other things that are going on. Did you hear about that house that got blown down? I got some video here. My guess is you've seen this.
Oh no, look at that!
So some interesting things about that. First of all, it was a couple miles from here. It was very close. I saw the storm on its way. My weather alert radio went off. My phone went off. I tuned in Skywarn and listened. And it was that happened about 3 or 4 miles from my house right here. And the video was really good because it was a professional videographer. A lot of the times when you see some actual eye reporter footage, camera shaking like crazy and disappears from the event to show something else just at the wrong time or the right time. So this guy's holding it nice and steady because he's a pro. He didn't know the house was going to fall down. He wanted to show people the storm. But, you know, right time, right place. You get lucky. What I wanted to say about that is that I was listening to Skywarn in that episode. It crossed right over my house. We had a lot of wind here, not as bad as that, but the RDU airport is about 4 miles north of me, and they registered an 87-mile-per-hour gust of wind, and this was a couple miles from that, so they might have had that severity of wind, you know, somewhere in there. And people started saying, well, shoddy construction. So the newspaper story the next day said, no, they hadn't been finished building it yet. So they hadn't put in all the bracing and everything wasn't nailed down. So it was vulnerable. Any new construction is vulnerable to 90-mile-an-hour winds, if that's what happens to come by. More finished, not even totally finished, but more finished construction right next to it stood up just fine. But we have to get online and say shoddy construction. But that wasn't where I was going. Where I was going was listening to Skywarn. And it occurred to me as I was listening that the Skywarn net control, and I've been a Skywarn net control, and I've probably been guilty of doing what I'm going to complain about now, would make these long, tedious announcements that they picked off of the National Weather Service, the warnings, listing all of the events and all of the counties that are involved and all the speeds and the motion and all that in one long transmission. I'm surprised you didn't time out. And I was thinking, I hope I don't end up with something urgent to tell Skywarn because I'm going to have to wait a long time before this guy stops talking and starts taking spotter reports. I did hear a good spotter report, and one that let me know what was just about to go by my house from a guy that was about 2 miles west of me. And the storm blew through him, said rain harder than he'd ever seen before, and really high winds and flooding. Skywarn has got some criteria, some things they only want you to call in and report. But of course, people call in and say, it's windy, it's raining, and other people make fun of reports like that. And that went on here. But this guy was only a couple miles away. And so I knew it was just about to hit. I was watching the radar, but the radar is always a couple of minutes behind. I was watching television. Their radar's a little bit closer. But it was still interesting to hear an on-the-spot report from somebody pretty nearby. I have a lot of respect for Skywarn and all the people that participate in it. And I want to do some more stories about Skywarn. But it's like everything else. It's got its upsides and it's got its problems. So anyway, but very, very cool video. I remember a story when I was a disc jockey back about making these long forecasts. When I was a disc jockey back in Arizona, I spent 3 months at a little radio station in Lake Havasu City, KFWJ. The owner was a ham. And although we got along well at the beginning, we didn't get along well after a very short period of time. I ended up talking a lot more than I was supposed to, than he wanted me to, and pretty soon I got fired. Even though he was a ham, he still fired me, which normally in the radio business is a stepping stone to a better career. But I had some other problems going on that someday I may tell you about, and you'll know why I didn't end up being a disc jockey anymore after that. So anyway, I was on the air, and and this was probably within the first 2 weeks or so that I was there. He, the owner, his name is Lee. I don't remember his call sign. He was out doing a remote, and I was talking back and forth to him. He was doing the commercials and the remote stuff. It was a boat show or an auto show or something that caused us to get out there in the field. He was doing the remote. I was back in the studio, and some in Arizona in the summertime, there's always thunderstorms popping up here and there, and that's what was coming up. On the radio, disc jockeys have learned to do something to speed up the weather forecast. They squeeze them right down. It's going to be sunny today, high about 85. It'll be fair tonight with a low in the mid-80s, and that wouldn't be likely if it's today is 85. Let me do an Arizona forecast. It's going to be sunny and warm today. We were told anything below 110 after May was warm, not hot. If it got above 110, then I saw typical days 110 to 115, and the hottest day I ever saw was 126. So it's going to be sunny and warm with a high of about 108, which is a pretty nice day in the summer in Arizona. But on this particular day, some thunderstorms coming by. And so I read that, the 75% chance of a thunderstorm, but these little thunderstorms roll by. You can stand outside, look at the mountains 100 miles away between you and them. There's this thunderstorm going by. It'll never hit you. It'll be sunny and clear skies where you are all day, but you'll see the thunderstorm roll by. You see a bunch of them. That's one of the interesting things about living out there. So I do that, and that's fine. And then I get to in the event that a severe thunderstorm comes near you, be sure to take shelter, blah, 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 blah. And the boss is sitting there waiting to do his remote and commercial and stuff. He says, are you really going to read all that, Gary? Well, it says so. It seems like really important. It didn't take long before I realized, no, shorten the weather forecast up. Get it short. So I did that pretty quick. The Skywarn net controls never learn that. Not something that they're taught. They read every last word that comes across their computer screen from the weather service. And they read it like it's the most important thing in the world. Go and do my Walter Cronkite. The most important thing in the world. And they need to read every word every time. After a while, this guy did start at least letting his push-to-talk button go so that someone with a report could break in. And maybe the coordinator called him and said, you're going to time out the repeater, dude. Shorten it up. Next. QST has had some trouble in Android. Brain that I've got going. Punch the right camera up. The brain here, this is a Nexus 7. It's the Galaxy Pure Google, not Galaxy, it's the Pure Google Experience Nexus 7. And a few weeks ago, it was upgraded to Android 4.4. Before that, I had been enjoying reading QST on it and being able to download it because ARRL and their provider, Nextbook, updated their Android app so that you could download QST. And I showed you some of that in a previous episode. It turns out that the download is about 250 to 300 megabytes. Pretty hefty, because it's got some of that video and stuff in it. The magazine itself wouldn't be that big, but it's got a couple of pieces of video, and video is a bandwidth hog. And so the downloads are fairly big, and they're slow. At least my experience is on the Nexus is that they're slow. This is capable of doing downloads with the bandwidth that I've got here. I've got Time Warner's Extreme that peaks out for downloads at about 30 megabits. This is doing Wi-Fi, of course, so it doesn't go quite that fast. But I see stuff up to 20 megabits. But the QST stuff comes in slow, a couple of megabits. It takes a while. So I tell it to start downloading and then just set it down and let it do its download. But it was better experience reading QST with the download than trying to read it online. But then they upgraded to 4.4 and things broke. And let me show you here on the brain cam and switch over to the QST app. So there's what QST looks like here. And the last few issues I have not downloaded. So when you look at them, you've got the option to read it or to download it. And if I were to do that, it would work. To read it, it would work. But down here a little bit, yeah, starting here, what is this? The October issue. That, by the way, is the one that my review of the Anytone Chinese dual band mobile, sort of a dual band mobile. No, it's a full dual band mobile. I'm letting the cat out of the bag on the Osheng / Waxon sort of a dual band mobile. That I've sent that review in, and it should it'll show up in a couple more issues. My phone is ringing. Not somebody I want to talk to. Swipe to go away. Love caller ID. All right, so where was I? The Osheng / Waxon review in a couple of issues coming up. The review has been sent in. I sent them a long version, and I knew that wasn't going to fly. And I sent them a shorter version. I already edited myself, cut it down by about a third. And the editor says, yeah, that's still probably a little bit too long, but we'll take some wax at it. He said, probably what I ought to do is talk to you about a word, you know, a goal for a word count. And I said, it doesn't matter because I got to write as much as there is and then start whacking stuff out. I can't really edit on the fly as I'm working on it because I don't know what's good and what's bad until I write it all. So I'll write it all. I also asked, and I don't know if this is going to fly, if they could put the whole thing, the long version, online, or if they don't want to do it, if I can do it. So we'll see. We'll see if anything. They do online stuff, longer articles on the technical stuff, where they've got schematics and more technical description, stuff like that. You can get extended versions of those articles online. They haven't done that with a review. They don't have anybody who writes reviews like I do. I don't think. Most of the other guys doing the reviews, they do good reviews, but they're very straightforward reviews. Mine, at least they don't start out that way. They end up a little bit more straightforward by the time they get in print, but they don't start out that way. Back to my brain. Okay, so the problem here is we'll go to the, if it says delete, that means it's online. So we'll go to this October version and we will take a look at it. And if you just look at it like that, you know, everything seems fine. Oh, trying to give me some instructions. There we are. Everything seems fine. But if you want to read an article, let's get to one. Come on. albeit, there we go. Suppose I wanted to read the article, we double tap it, and it pops up to the top. And that's pretty much what it does. And I can scroll across it, but I can't scroll down. There's no way to get to the stuff toward the bottom. And when it's full page, it's too small to read. So that's the bug, and it's been there for a while. And I sent them a note and said, there's a problem. And they sent me a note and said, yeah, we know, but thanks for confirming it. In fact, it is online. They have an acknowledgement that there's a problem. And there it is. Although they're saying it's the Android app on Samsung Galaxy tablets. And this is a Nexus, the pure Google Experience Nexus. It's not a Samsung, not a Galaxy. It is a tablet. So it popped up when Android 4.4 came around. So I suspect it's a problem with 4.4. And sooner or later, the folks that do this, and AWRL does not write this app. It is done by a company called Nextbook, and sooner or later, they'll fix it. If you're having this problem, you probably ought to complain about it. Maybe later we'll turn to sooner. All right, so I need to get my brain back. There we go. Thank you, Evernote. All right, so I was going to talk to you about CQ. CQ Magazine's December issue. All right, put it on brain cam. The December issue has just arrived. It is January 14th. It came yesterday, January 13th. There have been a bunch of complaints online about CQ coming late since sometime last summer. So I think they're having trouble up there in CQ land. I've done some interviews with their editor, Rich Moseson, W2VU. Met Rich a long time ago, back in the 90s. Helped him do some video when they did their first video series. That's where I met him. They came down here to Raleigh, among several places that they went to shoot video for some introduction and how-tos and things like that. They even did a little bit of video with Cindy, KD4ACW, at the time, my relatively brand new girlfriend, and eventually to become my wife, many years later. There's a story behind that too, but I'm not going to go into it now. Anyway, the program that they wanted to do on DX, they had gone to several places, to great big gun DXers over the course of a couple of weeks. And there was a big solar flare that happened just before they started shooting this. And these big DXers with these monster antennas on 150-foot towers were barely able to squeak out a signal from the U.S. to Europe. You know, they hear one signal on the band or nothing. They went to a very prominent, high-ranking DXer way up on the DX list here in Raleigh. I was over at her house, and she thought something was broken. I mean, she tuned across 20 meters in the middle of the afternoon, and this was pretty good part of a sunspot cycle, and nothing, not a signal to be heard on 20 meters. And she thought something had broken, but it was just that dead.
This is not a good day for DX. The bands are not very good, and he's not even moving the meter.
And then they went over to Cindy's house. Cindy had a little Tentec Argosy, one of the little Tentecs, and a dipole in the attic. And they pretty much wanted to show what you could put together. They knew they weren't going to hear anything because the bands were dead. But they wanted to show the radio and the antenna, a little dipole in the attic that her dad had built for her. And so she fires that up. The band is alive. And she starts working station after station, DX all over Europe, all over the place. She works Frankenstein's Castle. That's all on the video. It's a great video. And they show her, they even made a cartoon of her getting bitten by the DX bug.
Four Alpha Charlie Whiskey, temporary AA, QSL.
So, poor CQ. Things are not going well up there. They're going to take the print edition of CQ VHF and of Popular Communications are gone. They're no more print editions coming out. Starting with the February issue, it's all going to be online. joining one of the publications that CQ acquired some time ago, World Radio, took it from being the most low-end national or worldwide ham radio publication, a newsprint, and putting it online. Now, everything is going to be merged together in something they call CQ Plus. Let me take a look at the website that's talking about that. So here is here's CQ's website, and they're not really saying very much about it. If you look at just the website, it just looks kind of ordinary, even showing this December issue still as the current issue here on January 14th. But right down here, the launch of CQ Plus, the supplement to the digital edition of CQ, incorporating popular communications, World Radio, and CQ VHF. Click here for details. If you do that, you're not going to get details. You're going to get their online blog, and it's their story-by-story chronological news of stuff going on in ham radio. And you pretty much have to go way, way down to get just, first of all, a little bitty mention that CQ Communications is realigning its publication lineup. And then you go down a bunch further, and finally you get the big story. And this was announced at the end of last year, December 27th. And click this link. What it has taken us to is a look at the February issue. And the PDF I can blow up a little bit. So that's what the February issue of CQ is going to look like. And then down here, there's the CQ Plus. And this will be the stuff that has been formerly found in Popular Communications and CQ VHF and World Radio. And it's all going to be edited by Richard Fisher, KI6SN, if I recall his call sign. Did an interview with Richard some time ago. The 35th anniversary, I think, of Popular Communications. It's been around for a while. I've been subscribing to these for a good long time. I just checked my subscription. It is due to expire in March of this year. So I should be getting some information or notice on how to see this stuff online. And that hasn't come through, at least not for me yet. So we'll see. I think it's going to end up, first of all, I like this stuff online. There have been a lot of comments from folks who don't like the online versions, not making them happy. The usual stuff that you hear from people who prefer a print magazine, they want to be able to carry it into the library. Don't like reading on their computers. Tablets have made things pretty darn convenient for reading this. And the 7-inch tablet like the Nexus 7, about the bottom size that I'd want to be able to read this stuff on. The full-size tablet, an 8-10-inch, they look gorgeous on my wife's Apple iPad. Look better on the iPad than on this. Sad to say. I kind of like the Android stuff and all that, but I do have to admit that the magazines look better on an iPad and work better on an iPad. In any case, that stuff all works best for me, but there's still plenty of people that are complaining. You know, that's going to be the case no matter what, but we have that minor contingent here in ham radio that got their feet firmly planted 20 years in the past, or sometimes more. Does my brain want me to move on yet here? Let's see. Well, yeah, it does. So I'm looking forward to it going online. You don't have a choice. You'll still get the CQ Magazine print edition, but I will switch to all digital and then go enjoy everything digital. And I'm kind of disappointed in the state of the industry that is the ham radio industry that has caused CQ to have to do this. And if I get a chance and Rich is willing, I'll talk to him and do an interview sometime, hopefully soon, and see if he'll talk about what happened. People don't like to talk about bad news. He may say no, he doesn't want to go on camera and talk about it, but we'll see. I'll at least ask. So what else? Well, a couple things about Ham Radio Now, some of the email and some of the comments that people have made. I want to address, as long as I'm just kind of whining about things or musing about things. I get a fair number of two things come up most frequently about the programs that have been on here. And it occurs to me, I forgot to check my watch when I started, so I don't know how long this program has gone on, but longer than many of you want. Shorter shows. People want shorter shows. I understand. I'm probably not going to deliberately aim at shorter shows. I'm going to put in as much content as a program takes to get from one end to the other and not cut them apart and not end up making them deliberately shorter. Some programs will be longer than others. The other thing people complain about is that when I'm doing an interview with someone, I interrupt them a lot. And I say that's not an interruption, that's a conversation. But as I watch some of them, yeah, I may tend to dominate a conversation. I know I am not going to ask a polite question and listen to an answer until the person stops talking for 4 seconds and then ask the next polite question. That's never the way these programs are going to go. But I will be attempting to be conscious of the idea of not interrupting and at least letting someone finish their thought. It's only polite. When people talk to you about what they do in the creative realm, the successful people, they will tell you to do what feels right to you. Follow your muse. Do what seems right. And screw the focus groups. I know about focus groups. I have participated and edited videos from focus groups for years and years and years where someone will say, well, here's what we're thinking about doing. How does it strike you? Or typically somewhat more clandestine than that. They'll show a show. I don't know if they're still doing this, but they'll show a show. It's a terrible show. And it's a show produced just for the focus group. And then they'll put some test commercials in. They'll put some real commercials in and then some test commercials, some commercials they're thinking about doing, some concept ideas, and then back to the bad show. And it, you know, maybe it's a 10-minute show, it's a quick show. And then they'll talk to people. Well, what did you think about the show? Okay, well, what commercials did you remember? Why'd you remember that one? What was it about this one that you thought of? And then eventually they'll reveal where they've been going and say, okay, we're really talking about this commercial. What'd you think? And if the commercial scores high enough, they'll finish producing it and it'll go on the air and you'll get to see it on television. And if it doesn't score high enough, they'll go on to plan B. So, I hate focus groups. Anyone who's creative hates focus groups. I like to go with what's in your gut. But the other thing that successful people say, and this is not so much in the creative endeavors, but it's in the startups, the online, well, the small businesses, the entrepreneurial businesses, stuff funded by venture capital, much bigger than what I'm doing, but still small by Google or Apple comparison, is fail fast. Do this stuff. Get it out there, see if it works. If it doesn't work, shut it down and move on. So I'm not failing fast. I don't know if I'm failing. I know I'm not getting what I want out of Ham Radio Now. I'm having a great time. I'm getting programs on. You know, we're in the 140s, 150 somewhere, 125 official, 126 for this one is the official number, but there's a bunch more in there. So we're like in the 140s. That's a lot of programs in 2 years. And I'm really enjoying sitting here staring into this camera with no one else around, talking to you and putting it online. And if you're still here, hopefully you're enjoying watching me. But it's not being successful financially. So I am so confused. I don't know whether to fail fast. It's too late to fail fast, to fail and shut it down or keep trying and do something else. I'm 64. I'm not sure what else there is to do. I'm going to try to build in more freelance and stuff that'll make me some money. I can't afford to retire at this point, and I can't afford not to. Let me show you some cool stuff about Ham Radio Now, based on YouTube. Okay, this is the secret sauce inside YouTube. This is the dashboard. This is what somebody who owns a YouTube channel gets to see. And these are some of the most recent episodes. Now, this one went up just less than 24 hours ago, 115 people have seen it already. This one just a few hours before that, 201. And the numbers will go up as people are discovering this. The channel's got about 2,500 subscribers right now. Well, let's go to something that's got some respectable numbers here. This is the talk on MDSR. Do I remember what MDSR stood for? No, I remember it was a do-it-yourself software-defined radio stuff. So it got popular because people spread it around, over 2,000 views. But let's look at the stats. Let's look at some interesting things about this. We don't have to worry about earnings reports because I don't make anything off of off of YouTube. Views. Let's see. I'm going to squeeze that right up to the calendar from the day it was put online. So it starts slow, but it picks up views pretty quickly, and those are from typically the folks that are subscribed to it. I'm not sure what this big dip is for one day. And then a spike as it either got on QRZ.com or on some mailing list someplace, and then it fell off again. And people have been watching to the tune of, less than 100 a day till today. So that's interesting. The demographics are interesting. No kids. No lids, no kids, and no space cadets are watching these programs. A few folks in the 35 to 44, a big bump in the 45 to 54, a bigger bump in the 55 to 64, and then kind of falls off for us old fogies. Well, I'm still in this group here, but I'm just about to leave it. And it's almost all men. There's the women. I guess women don't care about software-defined radio. Not sure what we gain from that, so I'll move it on. This gets embedded a lot of different places. I don't have it on my Ham Radio Now website right now, so it's not embedded there. I'm not sure where it's embedded. I could probably find out. This is interesting, where people are watching it. Most people are still sitting at a computer to watch these. Just staring at their computer screen. Tablets, pretty good, but way below computers. Mobile phones, almost as good as tablets. So there's a contingent of folks who want to see it on their computer screen, sitting at a desk probably somewhere, and another contingent that's willing to watch it on something small. And then TV, I think that's going to be like Rokus and Chromecasts and stuff. Folks have asked me if I could get a Roku channel, and I probably could. Some of the other ham radio programs have gotten Roku channels. It's just a matter of learning how and going through the motions of getting it set up. I've got a Roku. I like it. If you've got a Roku 3, the new one, that finally lets you see YouTube, and you can watch from YouTube on your Roku. If you've got a Chromecast, you're all set. You can watch the YouTube stuff off of your Chromecast. A Roku channel, I'm not sure how much it would do for me in terms of bringing lots more people in. I mean, it wouldn't hurt. And it's something I'll try to do, but I've always felt like I've got programs I need to produce. And anytime I'm figuring out technology like Roku or YouTube or whatever, I'm not making programs. So I've concentrated on doing what I know how to do more than doing what I don't know how to do. One guy is watching on a game console once. So if we go back to the, where was it? The demographics. I don't know who's got the game console. Whoever it is, he's over 35. Somebody's got a game console. But here's my favorite statistic, the one I like to look at the most, and it's called audience retention. It's going to start up the program here.
Now episode 116.
I'm going to tell that to stop. But we can look at it in a moment. This is the second by second, minute by minute. What percentage of the audience of the folks from when it started are still watching? So it starts at 100%. And it falls off pretty quickly as folks sample the program. and decide it's not something that they want to watch, or it is, but not right now, or, you know, for whatever reason, they watch a couple of minutes and then move on. As we get to about the 50% point, it tends to even out, and then it drops slowly. These long programs always drop slowly until they reach about 25% at the very end. And on all the programs that I produce, all the long programs that are 45 minutes or longer, which is almost all of them, they look like that. Their chart looks like that. So everything falls off. I'm pretty sure everybody who does long-form programs, if they were to look at their audience retention chart on YouTube, it looks like that. There's another way to look at this. And that is the relative audience retention. Come on. There we go. That's interesting. I don't know all the stuff that goes behind it. I don't know how 100% of the very beginning can be below average. Although something about if people keep going back to the beginning and replaying, it can go above 100% from the very beginning. But that's not happening here. Wrong button. Push the right button. There we go. What was that? Oh, my lap. So the relative audience attention, it gets pretty big. And it drops off and it gets pretty big again. From this is the absolute, nearly a flat line, to bouncing up and down as relative. I don't really know how that works. But let's see what we were doing when we get to that spot. I'm still talking. Interesting. Fairly long introduction to this program. And that makes it easy. But a lot of radios don't. The 756 here does not have an easy way to...
So I'm still rambling on. And it even has a little peak as I'm still talking. And then we get to the point where I've introduced the guy who's doing the actual program. And as he talks, the audience slowly falls off. So, you know, folks have once again figured out whether he's talking about something that they want to watch. And you know more than I do about why you might stop watching somewhere in the middle of a program. Run out of time. Got to go do something else. Going to come back later and pick it up where you left off. If you can, maybe not. Maybe you've decided, I've seen all I want to see. I can't see getting in that far into a program and saying, no, I don't want to see anymore, because there's always going to be something interesting toward the end. But that is the inside look at what goes on deep inside YouTube. I get the same stuff from Blip. So I've reached the end. I have no idea how long I've been talking. I'll be interested to see. Hopefully it's not much more than an hour. That will be it for episode 126. Going to go back to, I'm almost going to go back to finishing up some Tapper videos. At this point in the year, there's something I have to do that's even more important than that. Nothing good, nothing for you. I have to do my taxes. I have to get them prepared and buttoned up and sent to the accountant. And these are the business taxes, because Ham Radio Now is part of my corporation, Pierce 10, Inc. It's an Inc. And send them off to the accountant and look at the bad news. So that will take me and file all the stuff with the IRS and the state and the county, everybody else who wants their piece of me. You want a piece of me? So got to do that. Or they'll come haul my butt off to jail and no more programs will be produced, because they don't let you produce programs inside jail. So I'll go do that. That'll take a day or two, and I've got some other bills to pay and some paperwork. You saw the back in the Christmas card episode, you saw the mess. I've got to get to some of that. Some of it is important. It's been piled up. And then probably by this weekend, I'll get back to more episodes. There's two more from Saturday. And then the Sunday deep dive, which is a four hour talk. And I will get that done. And it's probably going to be done sometime next week. And then I'll start doing the fulfillment of the rewards. Excuse me. So that is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Thank you for watching. Those of you who have stuck all the way here to the bitter end. One last mention. Arvin, I'm not going to pick you up because I'll be knocking over a bunch of handy talkies. Oh, you see this one? Let me waste a little more time. Tempo S1. One of the very first agile frequency synthesized
handhelds on the market. I was so looking forward to frequency synthesizers. And I thought when this came out that it was, be all the end all. Well, it had a built-in internal battery. You couldn't take it out. So once the battery died, you were done for the day, plugged it in and talked some more the next day. So if you talked a lot, then you didn't talk for long. You set the frequency by dial and thumb wheel switch, set the offset, the five kilohertz switch, set the offset with a plus minus switch on the back. The 600 kilohertz band plan allowed for that. There's the power plug. You plug an earphone into it. It didn't have an external microphone connector, but it had an external antenna connector. So you could plug an antenna, because it's not a BNC connector. It's kind of like a Motorola. I don't know if it was compatible with Motorola, but it was similar. And I think it was 5 watts. Some of the best sounding transmit audio I have ever heard on a 2-meter radio. Radio sounded great. Why can't radio sound this good anymore? I don't know. Anyway, Arvin, hamradionow.tv, click the pig, kick in some cash. We'll keep on going for the rest of the year if we can. Ham Radio Now, I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, 73, everybody. Thanks for watching. Over and out.
5x6 into Castle Frankenstein, near the city of Darmstadt in central Germany.
Frankenstein's castle?